Everybody, welcome to our Bible study on 1 Peter. And if you're just getting your things ready, I just want to encourage you to get your Bibles and your notebook out ready and your pens while the children are having Sunday school. We adults will be doing our Bible study. So this morning we sang in our worship that Christ is our hope, our strength, and our song. And it's so relevant to the Bible study that we're doing today. And I just want to do a little recap about what we did last week. If you didn't join us last week, feel free to tune in to our Facebook Live on our Facebook page to see what we learned last week. And just let me give you a little recap. Last week, we talked about the new life that God has blessed us with. And this new life is filled with a living hope. It gives us a new identity as God's chosen people. And it gives us a new purpose to live in obedience to God. Now, when we embrace this new life from God, it fills us with hope. And this hope has the capacity to become more real to us day by day. Now, I left the last study with a question. What about trials and hardships? And that might be a question that you might be asking today with all that's going on around us. Now, remember, Peter was writing to the Christians in the first century AD who were suffering intense hardships and for their faith in Jesus. And pressure was building against them systematically, and they were facing pressures from all angles, economically, emotionally, mentally, and physically. In 1 Peter chapter 4, we read that people were suffering beatings for their faith. Now, God's answer to them through Peter's letter is, new life in God includes experiencing hardships, trials, and pain, but great hope and joy is possible. Okay? New life includes experiencing trials, hardships, and pain, but great joy and hope is possible. Now, the Bible gives us a very realistic perspective about trials and hardships. In fact, it tells us to expect trials. All right. Now, having new life from God doesn't mean that Christians never have to suffer for our faith or that we'll be exempt from the pressures of difficulties. In fact, it says the exact opposite. Let's look at what it says, and we're going to show this verse on the slide in a moment. Let's pay attention to the words highlighted in orange. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 6 to 7. In all this, you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Now, further down in chapter 4, it says, my friends, do not be surprised at the terrible trouble which now comes to test you. Do not think that something strange is happening to you. Now go back to that slide on chapter 1, verse 6 to 7. Let's keep our eyes on that verse. And notice that it tells us we should expect trials. And these trials are temporary. You see that in that phrase, for a little while. They come in many forms, all kinds of trials. And they have a specific purpose. These come so that. So it's to refine and prove the genuineness of our faith. And notice the very first phrase in that verse, 6, that in spite of ongoing difficulties, we can still have joy. In all this, you greatly rejoice. Great joy. This is the amazing paradox of the Christian life. Joy and grief can be experienced together. See, the Bible doesn't provide escapist solutions to our human problems, and nowhere does it ignore, pretend away, water down, or belittle the magnitude of our pain. And if God doesn't belittle or pretend our pain away, we shouldn't either. There are some people who just are totally averse to pain. They do not want to even think about pain. They want to get rid of every single inconvenience in their life. But verse 6 acknowledges full well that Christians had to suffer grief. it says that in spite of grief, they could also experience great joy. Now, this is very different from just tolerating hardship. You know, ayo, what to do? Tahanlah, you know? Okay, this is a different kind of joy. It's genuine joy. Now, Peter writes, the reason for our joy is our new life. What keeps us going, even produces joy in us, is the living hope that comes from our new life in God. Now, the living hope. Hope in what? In God's promise of a future deliverance and a heavenly reward when Jesus comes again. And this helps us to look beyond the pain. True joy is not affected by external circumstances. And our joy doesn't come only from hoping in God. It comes as we grow in love for Jesus. Now, this is all the background to the title of our study today, New Life in God. And bear with me as I lay that foundation to go into that main teaching. Let's read 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 8 to 9. And it's coming up on the screen there for you. Though you have not seen him, Jesus, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. So, joy, great joy, comes as a result because of our love for Jesus. Not only because of our hope in Jesus, but because of our love for Jesus. It's our love in him, our belief in him, our gratitude for his amazing, unconditional love, and what he has done on the cross for us, our awareness, our perception of his presence with us amidst difficulties that will produce what the Bible passage described just now, an inexpressible and glorious joy. It's such a wonderful joy beyond the power of words to express. And it's not something that we get only when we go to heaven. It's something that we can and should experience as believers now on an ongoing basis. Can I invite us to pause and consider? Is my life filled with this kind of joy? Is joy present in abundance in my life? Or is joy missing in my life? Now today, if you're tuning in and you don't know Jesus personally, may I ask, do you wake up and go through each day sad, heavy laden, feeling there is no way out, that there is no hope? I think everyone goes through sadness and moments of, you know, maybe even depression. But do you feel that there is no way out, that there is no hope for you? The good news is that Jesus came to bring us a new life that fills us with a living hope and an inexpressible joy. You can have this joy. It exists. And it is possible only through Jesus. If you're a Christian, may I ask, are you living with the joy of the Lord? If not, what has stolen your joy? You know, social media postings on New Year's Eve, I'm sure we were all on our phones and just, you know, wishing everybody Happy New Year. So many people talked about their life journey in 2020, and they talked about the hardships that were arising, that arose out of COVID-19, and still happening, and the things that they learned in the past year. And many people, friends, even my friends, we posted photos of our families holding each other close, and I posted one of my family too. Someone sent me a rather unusual Happy New Year greeting on WhatsApp. And if you see on the screen there, it says, 2020 was tough. May your 2021 be as tender as this beef steak. Happy New Year. So I hope you're not distracted by thinking about lunch now, if this gave you any ideas about what to cook later. So of course, this picture immediately made me want to eat steak, despite the fact that I'm trying to go plant-based, but not very successfully now. But it also made me think about my heart. I looked at this steak and I thought, what does a tender steak taste like? And I thought about my heart. I thought about the intense challenges of the past year and how it's impacted all individuals and families, including my own. And you know, trials and hardships, they have a sneaky way of making people become bitter, disillusioned, disappointed, and hardened. I ask myself, how's my heart doing? Has my heart gotten old, hardened, cynical, cold, toward life, toward people, and most importantly, towards the most important person of all, God? A hard, cold heart makes me a selfish, inconsiderate, and unkind person. I know it. Is my heart in a place where it needs to become tender again? Friends, if we're asking how the joy of new life is possible in practice where there just seems to be too many difficulties to handle, we need to begin with God. And that's a message for me too. Because a new life toward God will be expressed in a transformed, joy-filled life, affecting every area of our life and our relationships. And the rest of 1 Peter in the book study the next few weeks develops this, but it tells us the first place we need to begin is our heart with God. Now, what does it mean to live a new life with God, with toward God, that's directed toward God? How can we live this new life toward Him? Well, today God's Word in 1 Peter chapter 1 reveals two simple truths. And the first is this. We need to hope in Jesus. Hope in Jesus. Now, if you were joining us in our church service a few weeks ago before the new year, Coach Jeevan of BFM fame shared with us some really great tips about how to grow in our new life, in life this year. And he was saying, if you focus on something blue, all you think about or look for or gravitate toward is something blue. And last week I said, if we think like a chicken, we'll act like a chicken. If you focus on the wrong things or the wrong people, the wrong goals, you'll miss God's plan for your life. Or let me develop it further. If you hope in the wrong things or the wrong people or the wrong goals, you'll miss what God has in store for you. Could it be that you're distracted from what God wants for your life with all that's been happening? And as a parent, I know there's so many things that have been happening to the end of the year, leading on to the new year. What about school? You know, things that we need to get settled and so on. Have we been distracted from what God wants for our lives? It's time to start with right thinking. Right thinking produces right behavior. And what is right thinking? It's God's way of thinking. What does God want us to focus on? What does He want you and me to focus on? He wants us to focus on Him. Fix our eyes on Him. Not just what He can give us, but on Him. He is the God of hope. In Romans chapter 15, verse 13, it reads, "May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust Him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit." The New Living Translation reads like this, "I pray that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust Him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit." Now, coming back to 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13, is the first verse that we're going to in the main teaching of the study. It has an interesting phrase about hope. It says, "Set your hope on what we are to receive when Jesus returns again." Now, I'd like to invite you to read it aloud together with me. Okay, let's read it aloud. "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at His coming." The New Living Translation reads, let's continue. "So prepare your minds for action and exercise self-control. Put all your hope in the gracious salvation that will come to you when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world." Now let's leave this verse on the screen. notice that we need to fix our hope on or in something. It says that put all your hope in. Now, this is more than having a forward-thinking mindset. It's a God-focused mindset. God's telling us to put our hope, in fact, it says that put all your hope in one thing. In what? Look at that verse. In the gracious salvation that will come to us when Jesus Christ is revealed to the world. Now, what's this? This is the amazing final that awaits us at the end of human history when Jesus returns again, when he will bring an end to all evil and we will experience the fulfillment of all God's promises and ultimate salvation. You know, midway through this year, we'll do a Bible study on the key themes in the book of Revelation, so that we can understand how the revelation of Jesus himself should impact how we live today. And it's going to strengthen us with endurance, gratefulness, and hope. And such a relevant theme for our church this year. Titus chapter 2, verse 13 describes this as a blessed hope. Let me read it to you. While we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, hope needs to be directed towards something. And in 1 Peter, we were urged, set our hope on. Set your hope on. Other translations say, put your hope in. Fix your hope in. Now, we all drink water, right? And if you set down your glass of water somewhere, you don't think of this maybe consciously, but you're setting it down on a particular spot. Right? Or if you're trying to charge your handphone, you put your phone charger into a wall socket where the power source is. Your mind is deliberately directing you to put that charger into the power source. Now, our hope is not in an object. Our hope is in a person, Jesus himself. And when we set our hope, we're fixing our hope, we're redirecting our minds to the person of Jesus himself. What have you been setting your hope on? Today I invite you to put your hope in Jesus, to look to Jesus and surrender your life to him. You know, when you say, Jesus, I've been living my life, I realize I've been living my life in total disregard of you. I've never thought of you, not even once. Or I hardly think of you. I don't think of you, I don't think of your ways. Please forgive me and come into my life. And if I ask Jesus, from now on, take over, guide me through the rest of my life, make me the person you want me to be. Now, when you pray this prayer, God hears you. God's word says he hears you, and he will answer you. He will give you a new life filled with a living hope, and you can have absolute confidence that while difficulties are present in this life, the end of the story, the Bible says, is one of victory, joy, God's justice, goodness, his good purposes being completely fulfilled when Jesus comes again. Now, if you and I have prayed this prayer before and we receive this new life in God, we need to keep on setting our hope in Jesus. How do we do that? Well, 1 Peter tells us we need to prepare our mind to do it. Now, just as our mind directed our hand to put a charger into the wall socket, hope is a deliberate action of the mind. Now, so people, you've been doing school online. I'm talking to students here. Have you ever been caught watching YouTube while the teacher is teaching in class? And the funniest response I've heard from some parents is, you know, the child saying, oh, wow, I didn't know how that screen got there. Okay, now, we all know your mind must have directed you to click on that Safari or Firefox, right? And then your mind told you to search for YouTube, right? Well, hope is a deliberate action of the mind. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 is there on your screen. It says, prepare your minds for action. Be completely sober in spirit, steadfast, self-disciplined, spiritually and morally alert. Fix your hope completely on the grace of God that is coming to you when Jesus Christ is revealed. I like how this other version puts it. Be alert and think straight. Put all your hope in how God will treat you with undeserved grace when Jesus Christ appears. Thinking straight is much needed today, and that's a message for me too. We need to keep ourselves alert and think straight. Don't get distracted. Don't deaden our brains and senses with countless hours on Netflix or whatever it is. It could be excessive alcohol, it could be sedatives, it could be even sleep deprivation through overwork. And that affects our clarity and our mental capacity. The Word of God says, be sober so that we can fix our hope on Jesus and the blessing that is to come. And the fulfillment of every single one of God's promises will come. And it is coming soon. 1 Peter 4:7, the end of all things is near. Therefore, be clear-minded and sober so that you can pray. And this week, the whole Church of Malaysia is coming together in one heart and mind to fast and pray, because we know that the end of all things is near. And we can't be praying the same prayers that we used to be praying before. If you go and read the first devotion of the NECF website, you'll find we can't be praying the same kind of prayers that we've been praying before. We need to really pray. So to live a new life toward God, we need to, first of all, set our hope in Jesus. Hope in the person of Jesus and the blessing of salvation that is to come. But fixing our hope in Jesus needs to lead to something more. And this brings me to my second point. Only 2 points in this study, hope in God. And the second point is we need to devote ourselves to God. See, hope is an action of the mind. Devotion puts all our hope into practice. When I was young, I grew up playing the piano and I loved it. I started playing the piano at age 4. And age 10, I pretty much devoted myself to playing it well as I could, and I spent hours each day practicing. And looking back, I really owe an apology to the neighbors and the long-suffering listeners, because at sometimes I would go up to 4 or 5 hours in practice. Now, so devotion to piano practice really required setting aside time, energy, and effort. And involved action, physical, mental, and emotional action. All of you who have devoted yourself to something know that if you try to do something really well and it doesn't really work out, you kind of get frustrated. So the emotions also involved in that process. Now, likewise, our devotion to God, concentrating our energies on following Him and His ways, requires much of us. It does. And we need to be willing to put in that effort. Why do we need to devote ourselves to God? Why? You know, we always talk about in work, the most important question that we need to ask ourselves to become good at something is the why, knowing the why behind our work. And why do we need to devote ourselves to God? Well, let's look at our life and think of what it would be like without God. If we're honest about it, our lives will forever remain empty without God. We can fill it with things, but they can never bring us the true life, peace, and joy that can only be found in God Himself. You might be going for one experience to another. You may be going for one food trip after another, but your life will forever remain empty without God. Pause and consider, what is your life right now? What is my life like right now? Or what was my life like before I decided to follow Jesus? The Bible says that our old life is an empty life. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors. The ESV uses the phrase futile ways, inherited from your forefathers. The New King James Version says, the aimless conduct received by tradition from your fathers. The Message version says the dead and empty-headed life you grew up in. See, Peter's appealing to his readers rationally. He's saying, you were redeemed from an empty way of life. Don't go back to it. And this morning in Pastor's message, we were talking about breaking from the past, from the negative. The Bible is very clear about what produces an empty way of life. What does it say? It's our old ways of living, our self-centered, selfish ways. And here's where I want you to direct your attention to verse 14 in that same chapter of 1 Peter. It says, so you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. Now, to those of us who have been married some years, we may be familiar with what life might look like if our husband or our wife lived only to satisfy his or her own desires. I'm not saying this about anybody in particular, but we can imagine if you've been married some number of years, you will have the life experience to know that from your friends, maybe you've had some experiences yourself too. If our spouse had no consideration at all for the family, the children, our elderly parents or others, what would life look like in our family? It would be a horrible life impacting others in a devastating way. Well, 1 Peter says that Jesus came to set us free from this kind of empty, futile, useless life. He came to earth more than 2,000 years ago to live among us, to be the very representation in his own bodily person of God's amazing love to us. He died on the cross to set us free, rescuing us from the bondage of sin and evil so that we can have a new life filled with hope in him. Now, we see this idea of setting free in 1 Peter. In verse 18 and 19, Peter uses the word redeemed, and it's there on your screen. Let's read it. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. Redeemed. What does redeemed mean? It basically means God paid a ransom for us. He released us. He set us free, liberated us, delivered us. How? And the verse said, not by things, not by objects, but by Jesus himself dying on the cross, shedding his blood as the sacrifice for our sins. Wow. Friends, when we honestly and accurately reflect on the futility of our past life and we appreciate what Jesus has done for us, this should motivate us to devote ourselves to God. Now, what is devotion to God? Devotion to God is obedience to him. Another word is holiness. Last week, we studied 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, and we dwelt on that verse quite a bit. We learned that God's purpose for us is obedience. God chose us to give us a new life as his chosen people with a new identity and a new purpose, and that purpose is obedience. Now, this idea is developed more here. God wants us to be holy, that is, devoted to him and his ways in all we do. Now, let's read this key verse aloud together. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14 to 16. You ready? Join me. So you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. But now you must be holy in everything you do, just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. Let's keep that slide over there. And let's go over that in our minds again slowly. Look at that. How many times does the word holy appear? Give it a count. One at the bottom there. Two, three, and four. Four times. And the emphasis is also made by that quote. That quote comes from Leviticus chapter 11, and chapter 19 and verse 20. So here the reasoning is simple. God is holy, therefore he expects us, his people, to be holy. There is no sin or darkness or evil in God. And so because God is pure, he wants us to be pure. Because he is loving, he wants us to be loving. Because he is just, he wants us to uphold justice. Imagine what this would look like if we practiced this in all our relationships, in our families, if we lived like that toward others around us. Imagine what the world would look like. See, when God tells us to live as his obedient children, he's saying, act like his obedient children. Act like what he's chosen us to be. Act like what he's declared us to be, God's children, the chosen people of God. Sometimes we're all about feelings. I don't feel like, you know, I'm very holy. I don't feel like doing this. I don't feel like doing that. God is saying, act like it. Do it. Now, holiness, obedience to God, involves us conforming to God's way. And Peter's going to elaborate on this. It's not my way, not my selfish desires, not the culture around us. In 1 Peter chapter 4, there's a list. Peter gives a list of what the culture in the first century AD looked like. And I quote, it's not there on you, but let me just read it to you. It says here, people were doing sexual sins, a few evil desires, drunkenness, wild and drunken parties, and hateful idol worship. So again, as I say, you know, if you're single or married, if you're a student or an adult, you know, we all come from a family. And if you're following this Bible study online so far, you're old enough, you can imagine what it might be like if your parents or your spouse or your friends or your colleagues indulged in any of the things listed in that list. I repeat, sexual sins, evil desires, drunkenness, wild and drunken parties, and hateful idol worship. These are all the reasons why trust gets betrayed. Selfish behavior creates havoc, insecurity, destroys families. Uncontrolled and wild habits cause relationships to break down. And so God's word lovingly commands us, don't conform to these things. Be devoted to God and his ways. Be holy, because God is holy, and we will experience the goodness and blessing that comes as a result of obeying him. Is it possible to live a life that is devoted to God? God tells us to be devoted to him, but is it possible to live this kind of life that's changed by his goodness and grace? The good news is yes. Yes, it is. No matter what your past is like, God can work in our lives through the Holy Spirit to enable us to live rightly. In the next book of 2 Peter, God assures us that he's done his part to help us live this life. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3 to 4. By his divine power, God has given us everything we need for living a godly life. We have received all of this by coming to know him, the one who called us to himself by means of his marvelous glory and excellence. And because of his glory and excellence, he has given us great and precious promises. These are promises that enable you to share in his divine nature, his holy nature, and escape the world's corruption caused by human desires. God has done his part. And he says in another verse that Jesus in heaven keeps interceding for us to help us do our part. What's our part? Our part is to treat God with reverence, awe, and respect. And we come back to the book of 1 Peter 1, verse 17. It says, since you call on a father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. Another version says, you pray to God and call him father. He judges each person's work equally. So while you are here on earth, you should live with respect for God. That's our part. to treat God with reverence, awe, and respect. When we do that, we position ourselves in humility before Him. We say, God, take the highest place in my life. You are my highest priority. When we treat God this way, we will devote Himself. We will devote ourselves to Him and His ways. And we'll conform our life to His ways so that our life will be changed by Him. And we'll be filled with that kind of joy that 1 Peter describes, knowing that we're living in God's purpose for us, even though challenges are all around us. Now, the reality, of course, is that we will still struggle to do the right thing. That's why the Bible is full of commands and reminders for us to be more like Jesus. Continue to be more like Jesus. We need to put in the effort, the devotion to be more like Jesus, to be self-controlled and follow His example. It's a daily effort we need to make to act like what God has declared us to be, obedient children of God. Now, here I really need to clarify that living a life devoted to God does not mean perfection. Perfection leads to despair. It does not mean a list of do's and don'ts. That leads to legalism. It doesn't lead to religious or ritualistic behavior, because that has nothing to do with heart change. Often we think that living a holy life means being a goody-two-shoes or a person who is strictly religious. We couldn't be more wrong. God's heart is more passionate about justice, mercy, human compassion, and true godly devotion rather than perfectionism, religious behaviors, rituals, even showy, expensive worship. A life of devotion to God, an obedient life, means being changed inwardly, having a new heart so that we reflect God's heart outwardly. So it's letting God shape and mold our heart, our desires, our thinking, and that leads us then to the right choices and the right actions. When we devote ourselves to God and we ask Him to change our heart into a heart like His, producing the right actions, He answers us. That's His promise. I'd like to close our study for the day by reading from the book of Micah and Isaiah in the Old Testament that shows us what God's heart is like. And as we devote our hearts to God, asking Him to change our hearts, we'll see the kind of devoted life God wants us to live. Micah chapter 6, verse 6 to 8. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before Him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of olive oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Isaiah 58, verses 5 to 7. This is the Lord speaking, and He says, This kind of special day is not what I want. This is not the way I want people to be sorry for what they have done. I don't want people just to bow their heads like a plant and wear rough cloth and lie in ashes to show their sadness. This is what you do on your special days when you do not eat. But do you think this is what the Lord wants? I will tell you the kind of special day I want. Free the people you have put in prison unfairly and undo their chains. Free those to whom you are unfair and stop their hard labor. Share your food with the hungry and bring poor homeless people into your own homes. When you see someone who has no clothes, give him yours. And don't refuse to help your own relatives. Friends, we started today's study reflecting on how hardships can make us lose our joy. Our hearts can become hardened toward life and others, especially God. But God's word says we can have joy amidst hardships and difficulties. We experience great, inexpressible joy, even though we go through suffering on account of our faith. It's possible. But we need to remember that this joy comes from our new life in God, not from things around us. Without God, our life is empty and futile. God has graciously blessed us with this new life through Jesus because of his great love for us. So what can we do to keep on living this new life toward God? What do we need to do? We need to, one, hope in Jesus. And two, devote ourselves to God and his ways. We need to live as his obedient children, reflecting God's heart, our Father heart, God's heart of mercy, justice, and compassion to all around us. Next week, we'll be going to explore more in the book of 1 Peter. But I'd like us to pause now as we close and pray and commit ourselves to the Lord, asking him to help us to hope in him and devote ourselves to him. Let's pray. Today, if you're tuned in and you've had enough of your old life, you want to leave it behind, God is inviting you to place your hope and faith in him through Jesus and receive his gift of new life. Jesus came to take away your sin. He came to give you a new heart, a new spirit that will transform you from the inside out. So if you want to receive God's invitation to have this new life, I invite you to pray along with me. Our Father in heaven, thank you for loving me. I accept that I've gone so far away from you and that I've sinned against you. I've done wrong things. I believe that you sent Jesus to save me from my sin by dying on the cross to pay the penalty for my sin and give me a new life. God, I confess that I want you to come into my life. Save me from my sin and be my Lord and take over my life. Lead me from now on in all the ways that I live my life. For those of us who already believe in Jesus, let's renew our hope in Jesus and choose to live a life devoted to God. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your amazing love for us, what you did on the cross to redeem us. We look to your coming again soon to fulfill all of God's promises to save us. Forgive us for taking our eyes off you and your heart for our world. Today we ask you to help us afresh to follow you wholly and completely. Help us to live the way you want us to live, holy lives devoted to you, impacting others with your compassion, your grace, and your truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. And if you have any questions or comments, I invite you to post a comment down below and I will be glad to get back to you. See you again next week.
wash away my sin? What can make me whole again? What can make me white as snow? Nothing but your royal blood. What can wash away my sin? What can make me whole again? What can make me white as snow? Nothing but your royal blood. What can heal the heart of stone? What can resurrect these bones? There's no other fount I know. Nothing but your royal blood. What can heal the heart of stone? What can resurrect these bones? There's no other fount I know. Nothing but your royal blood. Nothing but your royal blood.
Your blood will never lose its power. Your blood will never lose your victory.